For more videos on people's struggles, please subscribe to our YouTube channel.
Hello and welcome to Around the World in 8 Minutes, a show from People's Dispatch. In this show, we bring you stories of resistance and defiance from across the world, as the collective strength of the people fights back against the horrors of capitalism and imperialism, and strives for a better world. This year, on August 16th, the eve of the Indonesian Independence Day was marked by violent repression of West Papuan activists in the Papuan capital of Jayapura. This comes a day after a major protest in Jakarta on the occasion of the 56th anniversary of the New York Agreement that handed over sovereignty of West Papua from the Netherlands to Indonesia. According to a lawyer based in Indonesia, Veronica Kuman, over 168 people have been detained by the police, most of whom are those demanding West Papuan self-determination. In a Twitter post, Kuman posted pictures of several injured activists and has called for the member states of the Pacific Islands Forum to take note of the human rights abuse. Sources say police let loose repression on Papuan students in the city. Hostel rooms and dormitories of students were surrounded and attacked by police personnel, and dozens of students were arrested. There are rumors that local governments in Java are planning to evict West Papuan students too. The same repression reportedly also took place in the provinces of West Papua and Papua. Speaking to Radio New Zealand, Kuman said that at least 65 people were arrested in Jayapura, including several belonging to the United Liberation Movement for West Papua, which advocates Papuan independence. She also added that many who participated in a rally demanding self-determination were attacked by pro-government militia and the police. Earlier this week, the PIF held a meeting in Tuvalu to discuss the situation in West Papua and hosted West Papuan independence leader Benny Wenda. This attracted protest from the Indonesian government. In a joint communique, even though the leaders of the PIF reaffirmed their recognition of Indonesia's sovereignty over West Papua, they urged the Indonesian government to fix a date for the visit of the UN Human Rights Commissioner for an independent investigation on reports of human rights abuses. On August 10th, more than 2,000 LGBTQ rights activists marched in the Polish city of Plock, marking the first Pride parade in the city. The parade went peacefully amid provocations and threats from homophobic groups led by the ultra-right conservative sections in the country. Saturday's march in Plock is one of the 24 pride parades scheduled to take place this year in Poland. Activists say that these parades have been scheduled to send a strong message to the people of the country and in defense of gender rights and equality. Nearly a month ago, on July 20th, a 1,000-member-strong equality march in the northeastern city of Bialystok was attacked by far-right groups who used flash bombs, glass bottles and rocks. On July 27th, hundreds had protested in Warsaw, the capital city of Poland, against the attack on this Pride March. The Pride parade in Warsaw itself on June 8th had seen the participation of tens and thousands of people. LGBTQ rights groups and activists in Poland are constantly facing threats from right-wing groups, the ruling Law and Justice Party, PIS, and sections of the Catholic Church. The Law and Justice Party had consistently taken a strong stand against LGBTQ rights in the country and has made it a major campaign slogan in the upcoming national elections in October. The chairman of the party, Jaroslaw Kaczynski, has even labelled the LGBTQ rights movement a foreign import that threatens the country. In December 2018, Poland, along with Hungary, insisted on the removal of LGBTIQ rights from a joint statement from the Employment, Social Policy, Health and Consumer Affairs Council meeting held in Brussels. However, despite the constant attacks against the existence and the resistance of LGBTQ activists, things are beginning to change. The recently founded Wiosna Spring Party has declared full support and solidarity to the movement in the country. The centre-left party, founded in February 2019, won 3 seats in the European parliamentary elections held on May 26. Over 100,000 peasant women took part in the 2019 Daisies March, held in the city of Brasilia in Brazil on August 13th and 14th. This was the sixth edition of the Daisies March, originally called the Marcha de Margaritas, which pays tribute to Margarita Maria Alves, a union leader in the northeastern state of Paraiba. Margarita, who fought for rural workers' rights, was murdered by contract killers hired by big landowners in 1983. Since 2000, organized female workers from rural areas, the forested areas and urban areas hold the Daisies March to continue Margarita Alves' struggle, demanding workers' rights and the end of land conflicts and all forms of violence and oppression. The march happens once in 4 years. Brasil de Fato reported that on Tuesday night, nearly 30,000 people took place in the opening ceremony of the Daisies March. The motto of this march was Margaritas fighting for Brazil with people's sovereignty, democracy, justice, equality, and freedom from violence. The celebration saw caravans mobilizing from all the regions of the country and representatives from around 25 other countries. Artists, members of Congress, and other political figures also joined the crowd. The event also saw debate based on a platform seeking a number of rights, especially in the area of public education and healthcare, the fight to end violence against women, and the defense of the country's pension system. During the opening ceremony, different voices spoke about how important it is to unite women to fight gender violence and in the context of setbacks faced under the recent government. This time, the event was also joined by participants of the first Indigenous Women's March. Attempts by the Canadian firm Dalradian Gold to conduct mining operations on the Sperrin Hills in the northern Irish county of Tyrone have led to widespread protests from the residents of Greencastle. The protesters, under the banner Save Our Sperrin SOS, have set up a camp called the Greencastle People's Office on land allotted to the company. The Irish Times reported that Dalradian Gold had filed a planning application to build an underground mine along with the associated surface development projects in 2017. The major objection raised by the residents was against the proposed use of cyanide in gold extraction. Additionally, they opposed a proposal to build a huge mound during the mining process as it would damage the landscape. The Canadian firm recently announced that it would not use cyanide. However, the residents are not satisfied with the announcement and are continuing their agitation. On August 14th, SOS asked the Department for Infrastructure to clarify the status of Dalradian's planning application after the company admitted the hazardous effects of the use of cyanide in gold extraction, which they had earlier denied. At the same time, SOS demanded similar revision of most of the claims made by the company over several other concerns raised by the local community. Dalradian Gold had projected the mine at Sperrin Hill to be one of Europe's largest gold resources and claimed that the exploitation of gold would bring economic benefits to Northern Ireland. The protesters, however, have reiterated that they wanted Dalradian to abandon this project forever, as Sperrin Hills is home to several special areas of conservation and areas of special scientific interest, and the project could have a catastrophic impact on the environment. That's all we have for this episode of Around the World in 8 Minutes. For more such stories and videos, visit our website peoplesdispatch.org and follow us on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for watching.